American Dream never lied to you. We can't lie to you. We can't beat it. Awesome's the word. When the Russians can't put a spaceship on the moon, that ain't awesome. Awesome is
ATG.
Awesome is Tom Stivers. Awesome is ideals. And if you can't deal with us, then we gonna come deal with you. And you don't want that mess around your house, cause we gonna knock you out. Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, Forsyth, Georgia. $99 over factory cost. When I just came from the big arena overseas over there in Tokyo, Japan, I got in the cab outside. I got a General Motors car. I said to the Japanese cab driver, I said, hey, Japanese cab driver. He said, what is it, Dream? I said, where you get this General Motors car? He say, Forsyth, Georgia. I say, all right. That's bad, Jack.
Man, this shit's gonna be called quota.
Down to business. I got my wild cherry diet Pepsi, and I got my blackjack gum here, and I got that feeling. Yeah, that familiar feeling that something rank is going down out there.
And we are back, Hall of ATG podcast. We've got our April ballot breakdown. A lot of new faces on the ballot this month that Toad and I are going to get into in just a moment. Obviously, rough month the past couple months. No inductees. Really thought we had a chance last month, but it did not come to pass. So we have had a great purge from the ballot. A lot of all-time greats have dropped off after their fifth ballot. And we have an influx of some new blood this month that we're going to break down for you, let you know why they should or should not get your vote on this ballot. But before we get into that, really quickly, we're going to make a quick run through our returnees. As I said, a lot of people dropped off, but there are some really good candidates still on the ballot who are, in a lot of cases, on their fourth or fifth ballot, so getting close to dropping off. So just a quick run through of some of the people that are still on here and are really viable candidates to get in. So we've got Vita Blue on his fourth ballot. We've got Barry Bonds on his fifth and final ballot. We got Roger Clemens on the fourth ballot. We got Kurt Flood on the fourth. We have the return of ATG fave Jeff Kent. So he is on his second ballot. He'll be in the modern era for this. We've got Sandy Koufax on his fourth. Joe Morgan on his fifth and final. We've got Sadaharu Oh on his fourth. We have got Manny Ramirez is back on his second ballot. And then we've got Frank Robinson on his fifth. We've got A-Rod, who's also back for a second ballot. And then Carl Yastrzemski on his fourth. So that's our modern returnees. Classic era, we've got Yogi Berra, who has been re-added for his second ballot. We have got Mordecai Three Finger Brown on his third. Roy Campanella on his third. We have got the Christian Gentleman, Christy Mathewson, on his fifth and final. We've got Stan Musial on his fifth and final. And then we've got Buck O'Neill on his fourth. And then Victor Starfin on his fourth as well. So a lot of good candidates still out there. So be sure to review the returnees as well as the new people that we're going to get into. But yeah, we will go ahead and we'll turn things over to, well, myself and Toad as well. And we're going to kind of go back and forth here, break down some of the new candidates on the ballot for this month. So yeah, we'll get into that and we'll see you guys back for the closer.
Choi Dong-won might not have been the greatest pitcher in South Korean baseball history. That title would probably go to his rival Sun Dong-yeol. But what he can claim is being Korea's most important, most historically significant, most beloved, and probably most interesting pitcher. Choi got his start in baseball as a high school student, before a professional Korean league was founded. He set the record for most strikeouts in a major tournament game with 20. In university, he had a 23-game consecutive winning streak. Soon after, he joined South Korea's national baseball team. He helped South Korea win its first championship in international competition in 1977, and then its first amateur World Series, an amateur invitational event that was a predecessor of the World Baseball Classic, in 1982. This success in international play caught the attention of Pat Gillick's Toronto Blue Jays, who scouted and then signed the young player in 1982, claiming he was MLB-ready. He thus almost became the first Korean-born player in Major League Baseball. However, the authoritarian Fifth Republic government led by military dictator Chun Doo-hwan had other plans. They attempted to impress him into mandatory army service, which he could only avoid by voiding his contract with the Blue Jays and instead joining the newly formed KBO League, a domestic Korean league run under the eye of Chun's government. Choi remained one of the best pitchers in KBO competition. In 8 seasons, he put up a 2.46 ERA, an ERA plus of 142, a 230 FIP, 103 wins, 26 saves, and 1,019 strikeouts. He was the first KBO pitcher to reach 1,000 strikeouts. He was given the nickname Iron Arm for his ability to maintain a high-velocity fastball late into games, or pitch effectively on short rest, both rare skills in the early KBO. His greatest single season came in 1984, where he topped 27 wins, led the league in innings pitched with 284.7, and strikeouts with 223, won the MVP award, and pitched in 5 of 7 games of Korea's World Series to lead the Lotte Giants to its first championship. On May 16, 1987, he provided one of the most nail-biting pitching duels in baseball history. Facing off against his rival Sun Dong-yeol, the determined Choi threw 209 pitches in 15 innings, while Sun threw 232. The game ended in a 2-2 tie after the 15th. The game did much to spread the KBO League's popularity within South Korea, and to affirm its status as a competitive league with real stakes, and it's largely regarded as the league's most shining moment. Choi attempted to form the first Players Association in 1988, but it was broken up by the owners the same year. After being traded in retaliation to another team, and struggling to regain his Lotte Giants form, he quit the sport 2 years later. Wikipedia mentions he quote-unquote dabbled in politics following his retirement and South Korea's democratization, but I can't find what this comment is referring to specifically. Choi passed away in 2011. That year, the Lotte Giants retired his number, which coincidentally was also number 11. And he was also the subject of the 2011 film Perfect Game, about the aforementioned 1987 15-inning game. He was portrayed by actor Cho Sung-woo. Since then, the KBO's Best Pitcher of the Year award has also been named in his honor. Looking back on his career, he said, quote, "If I had to go back to 1984, I'd still pitch from Game 1 through Game 7. Why? Because that's what Choi Dong-hwan does." End quote.
Julio Franco, a shortstop, second baseman, and first baseman for many, many clubs throughout his career. The accumulator to end all accumulators, as Toad put it. Journeyman player, would play for any team or league who would pay him, and hit well in absolutely every place he went. He's a three-time All-Star, five-time Silver Slugger, batting title in 1991, and has one NPB Gold Glove. 4,008 recorded hits. Huge number. If you add in Winter League stats, he's got 200 more in addition to that. MLB hits 2,586. Only player in history to reach 4,000 hits and not be inducted into any halls of fame. This guy played in the U.S., he played in the Dominican, played in Mexico, played in Japan, and played in South Korea. He is the oldest regularly playing position player in MLB history. Oldest player in the MLB to hit a home run at age 48, and he was still playing as late as 2015 with the Ishikawa Million Stars at age 56. Most hits by a Dominican-born player at the time of his retirement. Legend, Julio Franco, shortstop, second base, first base.
Of the hundreds of candidates ever inducted to Cooperstown, only six were primarily inducted for their service as a general manager. And of those, the first four were inducted for working with a New York team, such as Branch Rickey with the Dodgers, or George Weiss of the New York Yankees and Mets. Pat Gillick bucked that trend, not only becoming the first general manager inducted outside of New York, but the first general manager of the modern era to be inducted entirely. Getting his start working under legendary USC coach Rod Dedeaux, while a college student, he rose through the ranks to become the general manager of the Toronto Blue Jays. Gillick led the young expansion franchise to five division titles and two World Series victories through terrific player scouting, as well as developing new markets for players, such as the then underutilized Dominican Republic with Epi Guerrero. Gillick would try to find market inefficiencies wherever he could to find talent. Describing his philosophy on finding players, he said, quote, "There are five or six rivers flowing into one river, fish in all of them." Another such river was the Rule 5 draft, which he was one of the first GMs to treat as serious business. He found many role players and even stars this way, such as Willie Upshaw, George Bell, Manny Lee, and Kelly Gruber, forcing other teams to become smarter about protecting their players. Gillick could also be a shrewd manipulator in trades. He selected Rico Carty in the Jays' expansion draft in order to force the Cleveland franchise to trade for their fan-favorite player back, obtaining catcher Rick Cerrone in the process, and coaxed Fred McGriff from the Yankees by initially proposing a trade for Don Mattingly instead, then waited for the Yankees to name McGriff themselves so that he could pretend to quote-unquote settle for the player he actually wanted. In the mid-1990s, he brought the Orioles to their only postseason appearances that decade, through bolstering the team through shrewd free agency moves. As Mariners GM in the early 2000s, he opened up yet another river by starting a posting pipeline with NPB that led to stars Ichiro Suzuki and Kazuhiro Sasaki signing with the team, and led the team to its famous 116-win season despite the team losing both Griffey and Rodriguez. He capped off his illustrious career with another World Series title with the Phillies in 2008. Throughout Gillick's career, he was often loyal to particular players. For example, he dragged Arthur Rhodes with him across three different tenures, with different teams. In addition to his induction to Cooperstown, he was also inducted to the Canadian Baseball Hall of Fame in 1997, and became a naturalized Canadian citizen in 2004.
So here's one we've been waiting for. From Walnut Creek, California, we've got the big unit, Randy Johnson, left-handed pitcher, top 10 all-time among pitchers in career WAR, and the most recently playing pitcher to get in that club. He's got the highest career strikeout per nine mark of any pitcher with at least 3,000 innings at 10.6. He's also second all-time in raw strikeouts and led the league in strikeouts nine times. 303 wins, so he's a member of the 300-win club. Most shutouts of any starting pitcher since 1988. He's a 10-time All-Star. It's a five-time Cy Young Award winner, including four straight between 99 and 2002. He's got four ERA titles and won a pitching triple crown in 2002. Led the Diamondbacks to a World Series championship in 2001, picking up World Series MVP. And he's one of only a few select pitchers who have thrown an official perfect game. And he was the oldest to do that at age 40. He's also one of five pitchers to throw a no-hitter in both the American and National Leagues. Now works as a professional photographer. You know, I had to add that in there. And the logo for his business is, of course, a dead bird from his unfortunate bird murdering incident. First player to be inducted into the Cooperstown Hall of Fame as a Diamondback. That is 6'10". The big unit, left-handed pitcher, Randy Johnson.
Not to be confused with an adjective for a salt solution with a pH above 7, Al Kaline was an all-around hitter with a remarkably strong arm who played for the Tigers for his entire career. Mr. Tiger, as he was known, was an 18-time All-Star, won 10 gold gloves, and a batting title in 1955. He never won an MVP award, but finished second in voting twice. Those gold gloves were well-earned by modern zone base metrics, by the way. He topped out at 29 TZR in 1961, and is 20th all-time in that stat. When he finished his career, Kaline had just over 3,000 hits, and one shy of 400 home runs. From 1955 onwards, he never hit more than 30 home runs in any season, but never hit fewer than 10, even in injury-shortened seasons, demonstrating remarkable consistency. Although he played much of his career in the 1960s low offensive environment, his 134 OPS plus puts him on par with modern sluggers like Fred McGriff, Ryan Braun, and Mookie Betts. Kaline made his debut at the young age of 18 in 1953 as one of the pre-draft bonus babies. His batting title at age 20 is the youngest of any player. His return to the field from injury just before the 1968 World Series led to manager Mayo Smith making the unorthodox decision to move center fielder Mickey Stanley to shortstop so that Kaline could stay in the lineup and play outfield. The Tigers won the World Series, with Kaline hitting .379 and Stanley playing a respectable shortstop, making the coaching decision one of the most praised of the era. Late in his career, Kaline's life was saved by teammate Willie Horton in 1970, after a collision in the outfield with Jim Northup blocked Kaline's airway, which Horton provided first aid to unblock. As I said before, Kaline spent his entire career with the Tigers, and that's not just as a player. After leaving the outfield, he served as the color commentator on local Tigers broadcasts through 2002, and then as a front office assistant with the Tigers until his death in 2020. That's a cumulative 67 years with the same club. The icon of Detroit baseball was inducted to the Cooperstown Hall of Fame on his first ballot in 1980.
Willie McCovey, first baseman and left fielder, primarily for the San Francisco Giants. So Willie was a power hitter, line drive hitter, retired with 521 home runs, so seventh all-time at the time of his retirement, and still top 20 today. Led the league in home runs three times, led the league in OPS plus three times, slugging percentage three times, RBIs twice, and intentional walks four times. He was the 1969 league MVP, he's a six-time All-Star, and he was the 1959 Rookie of the Year. He has the most intentional walks drawn in a season by a player not named Barry Bonds. He did that in 1969 with 45. That's a definite sign of a feared hitter. In general, his .270 batting average is a bit misleading. He played a lot of his career during, you know, the era of the pitcher, the 60s, kind of the second dead ball era, and he also drew a ton of walks. OBP is over 100 points higher than his batting average is. So Giants legend. Since 1980, they've been giving the Willie Mack Award to the most inspirational player on the Giants every year. And he's also the namesake of McCovey Cove. So that is the body of water behind right field. You've seen a lot of Jock Peterson home runs out there, a lot of Barry Bonds home runs out there. But that is Willie McCovey, first baseman, left fielder, San Francisco Giants.
Phil Niekro is probably the knuckleball pitcher of all time. It's hard to think of any knuckleball specialist that has achieved the level of success that he has. Niekro is the only pitcher to score over 300 MLB wins and 3,000 strikeouts with the unorthodox pitching style. The low strain the knuckleball placed on his arm allowed him to pitch for both longevity. He has the most wins of any pitcher after his age 40 season with 121, and volume, with four seasons with over 300 innings pitched, three with over 40 starts, and he is fourth all-time in cumulative innings pitched. He was the last knuckleballer to lead his league in strikeouts until R.A. Dickey in 2012, and he is 11th all-time in strikeouts, albeit primarily via volume rather than rate, with 3,342. Unfortunately, his high innings total, as well as the knuckleball's notorious inconsistency, put him in some ignominious places on the all-time leaderboards as well, such as being fourth all-time in home runs allowed, third all-time in walks allowed, and seventh in wild pitches. Still, his black ink in good stats more than makes up for that. I suppose that's just the price of being such a good pitcher and being used so much. Phil was a five-time All-Star, fielded his position with five gold gloves, and scored the ERA title in 1967. He also led his league in wins twice. Together with fellow knuckleballer Joe Niekro, he holds the record for the most wins between a pair of brothers, with 539. He served as a manager, but not in MLB. He managed the all-female Colorado Silver Bullets team in the late 1990s. He also kept busy serving as a primary link in the knuckleball coaching tree, mentoring Tim Wakefield, Steve Sparks, and R.A. Dickey at various points. Finally, I found online that he was the designer of something called the Nuxie Sandwich, which is barbecued pulled pork, onions, pickles, and coleslaw atop a corn muffin. Apparently, it's sold at the Gwinnett Stripers minor league stadium. Niekro was inducted to Cooperstown in 1997 and was an inaugural member of the Braves Team Hall of Fame.
Now we have got the spitball man himself, Williamston, North Carolina's very own Gaylord Perry, right-handed pitcher for a wide variety of Major League Baseball teams. Long-time pitcher in the league, allegedly was a fan of doctoring the baseball. Who's to say, really? He definitely played into this and would touch different parts of his head while pitching, so it would mess with batters, not knowing, okay, is he getting Vaseline or is he not, or what's going on? Despite this reputation, only ejected for doctoring the ball one time in 1982. We've probably all seen the video of that. Career ERA of 3.11, career ERA plus of 117. This man led the league in wins three times, led the league in complete games twice, and shutouts in ERA once each. He's a two-time Cy Young Award winner. He's a five-time All-Star. He's top 10 all-time in strikeouts, innings pitched, and games started. Also, 314 career wins, so in the 300-win club. He is the second pitcher after Walter Johnson to reach 3,000 strikeouts and 3,000 wins. Played the largest chunk of his career with the Giants, but I think everyone would agree that he's most well known as a Texas Ranger great. The one downside, apparently Frank Robinson and him hated each other. Typically, I don't like people that Frank Robinson doesn't like, but I'm going to make an exception. Right-handed pitcher for a variety of teams, spitball legend, Gaylord Perry.
The world to know, I got my Learjet sitting right out there at Creek City Cab. And in just about 20 minutes, I'm going to ease down the steps, Ted Turner by my side, getting my limousine, ride on 85, getting my Learjet. Woo! And take off to New Orleans. You got it, New Orleans. If you're watching right now, I'm 42,000 feet easing on in. Because in several hours, woo, I'm going to walk that aisle looking as only the nature boy can look. I'm going to ease across the street to the High Regency and drinks. All the champagne, anything you want, is on the world check.
What's causing all this stuff, Gerber? What's causing all this?
That's the man, the heavyweight.
Mine is, what's causing all this, huh? Go for it, Tony, tell your wife I said hello, guy.
The heavyweight champion of the world, nature boy Ric Flair, don't you dare go away.
Grover Alexander's Sabre bio begins with the following quote. Quote, had Grover Cleveland Alexander been a writer, the French would have called him a poète maudit, or cursed poet. Alexander had within him the greatness and the frailty that make for tragedy. Except for Ty Cobb among his contemporaries, no other player had to cope with so many personal demons. End quote. Grover Cleveland Alexander, yes, he was named for the president, was a dominant pitcher who was the face of the late 1910s Phillies. He won 373 games, the third most of all time, and pitched to a 2.56 career ERA. A workhorse even by the standards of the era, he led his league in innings pitched seven times, He also led his league in wins 6 times, ERA 5 times, strikeouts 6 times, walks per 9 innings 5 times, strikeouts per walk 3 times, and shutouts 7 times. In 5 seasons, he had an ERA below 2.00, reaching a low point of 1.22 in 1915. He won 3 pitching triple crowns in 1915, 1916, and 1920. In 1911, he set the record for the most wins by a non-19th century rookie, with 28. And at the tail end of his career, he won a World Series with the Cardinals in 1926 at age 39. In that series, he pitched 2 complete games, only allowed 3 earned runs, and got the save in Game 7 to boot. However, despite all this statistical success, it's still possible to wonder what could have been if not for Alexander's struggles with addiction and mental health. Alexander was arguably the greatest player in history with epilepsy, which he developed following a mustard gas injury in World War I service, alongside a form of wartime PTSD called shell shock. At the time, onlookers often misinterpreted his epileptic seizures as being caused by his struggles with alcoholism, which prevented him from getting proper care for his mental health, or care for the alcoholism for that matter. Between these struggles and a lack of savings due to his low reserve clause era salary, Alexander fell into deep poverty following his retirement. Things got so bad that he inspired one of the first MLB pensions. The Cardinals sent him $50 a month to supplement his army pension and barnstorming income in order to keep him above water, and more importantly, to avoid angry letters from fans who knew about his true status. Speaking of those barnstorming activities, most notably, he ran a House of David offshoot team through the 1930s and early 1940s alongside J.L. Wilkinson, the owner of the Kansas City Monarchs. Alexander and his cult buddies frequently played against Wilkinson's primary team in exhibitions. Alexander was inducted to Cooperstown in 1938, although he lamented that his induction wasn't something that he could eat. Bookending the presidential trivia, he was portrayed by Ronald Reagan in the film The Winning Team, a 1952 film about his World Series heroics 26 years prior. If you ask someone who doesn't follow baseball at all to name some famous figures from baseball, Yogi Berra would almost certainly be near the top of that list. In all of baseball history, there's scarcely been a player more quotable, more popular, or with a personality more memorable than Yogi. To the general public, he's probably most known for such frequent tautological phrases as, "It ain't over till it's over," "The record would stand until it was broken," "You can observe a lot by watching," "It's deja vu all over again," and "Nobody goes there anymore. It's too crowded." Speaking on the matter of his quotations, he's remembered to have said, "I didn't really say everything I said," and his son claimed, "Our similarities are different." But it's one thing to be a cult icon for malapropisms. How is his actual play? Well, for one, he's a 3-time MVP and 18-time All-Star. That's the most career All-Star game appearances by a catcher, and is tied with Roy Campanella for the most MVP wins by a catcher. He was a fixture in the World Series, winning 10 as a player and 3 as a manager, participating in 16 total. The most dominant stretch of Yankee baseball was all achieved with him behind the dish. On offense, he holds the record for the most career RBI for a catcher, and he also had the most career home runs and hits by a catcher at the time of his retirement. He was probably best known as a good bad ball hitter, able to turn pitches that would otherwise be taken for a ball, or swung and missed for a strike, into hits. He was also known for his quote-unquote clutch hits in big moments, inasmuch as clutch could be said to exist. Hector Lopez, in an interview, said, "Yogi had the fastest bat he ever saw." Defensively, he holds the record for most career shutouts caught by a catcher, with 173. He was the catcher for Don Larsen's World Series perfect game, and held a 148-game errorless streak. All that on top of being one of the most colorful characters of his era. Growing up in a predominantly Italian-American community in St. Louis alongside fellow catcher and Buck O'Neill Award winner Joe Garagiola Sr., Berra went on to not only fight in World War II, but participated in the D-Day landings and earned a Purple Heart. Although celebrity endorsements have always existed in sports, he was one of the first baseball players to deliberately seek them out to supplement his income. He appeared in ads for a variety of products including Yoo-Hoo, Pringles, Camel cigarettes, and even U.S. Treasury bonds. he was probably the namesake of the cartoon character Yogi Bear. He actually sued Hanna-Barbera for defamation. He ended up dropping the case since he couldn't prove any malice, but legal scholars argue that Hanna-Barbera's defense that the name was a mere coincidence was equally implausible. He also famously confronted teammate Phil Lynns over his harmonica playing after a losing streak in 1964, an incident which has a shockingly long Wikipedia article. Barrow was inducted to Cooperstown in 1972, was given a plaque in Monument Park, and was named to MLB's All-Century team in 1999.
This one, very near and dear to my heart, from Waco, Texas, left-handed pitcher Mr. Andy Cooper. So one of the few relief pitching stars of the classic era, his career saves leader among Negro League pitchers with 24, also led his league in saves twice, got a career 3.58 ERA, a little misleading. We got a high run environment, so that ERA plus is 122, looking better. Career 118 and 64 win-loss record, so that's almost two wins for every loss. Led his league in shutouts one time. He's a two-time All-Star. He never won a postseason title, but postseason pitcher. 1.87 ERA in 33.7 postseason innings. Notable for barnstorming appearances, this is what I'm talking about. Made his start with the Dallas Black Giants in 1919. You can pitch with Andy Cooper, ATG Barnstorm, the show 22. Go get it right now. Also conducted a tour of Hawaii and Japan in 1927. Classic era relief pitching, Andy Cooper. Go play with him, Dallas Black Giants, ATG Barnstorm. Hit some bombs with Charles Elder while you're there. Camden, South Carolina's favorite son, center fielder, second baseman, Mr. Larry Doby, broke a color barrier in two different top-level leagues. So in late 47, he signed with Cleveland, the first Black American League player, and also was one of the first two Black players in the MPB's Central League with who, of course, my very own Chinichi Dragons. Larry's a nine-time All-Star. He led his league in OPS twice, led the league in home runs twice, triples one time, hits one time, runs one time, RBIs one time. That's a well-rounded baseball player. Top 10 in OPS plus every year from 1948 to 1957, except one. He's won two rings, one in the Negro Leagues with the Newark Eagles, 1946, and won a World Series with Cleveland in 1948, in which Game 4 became the first Black player to hit a World Series home run. Like many players of his era, lost 2 years to military service in World War II, so that's going to hurt the stats a little bit. As a little fun fact Toad gave to us, went by the name Larry Walker when trying to disguise himself to preserve his amateur status. So a little, little modern-day shout-out there. Inducted into the Cooperstown Hall of Fame, 1998, barrier breaker, Camden, South Carolina, Larry Doby.
Of all the names on this list, Ox Eghart might be the single most obscure. After all, he only made his National League debut at age 30, and even then only made it to 57 plate appearances, with a whopping one home run and a paltry 192 batting average. Certainly not a record that would normally be getting second looks on a Hall of Fame ballot. But not all is as it seems, because while his time in the traditional major leagues was short and uneventful, Eghart had one of the greatest minor league careers in baseball history. Although even calling it that would probably be selling him short. Prior to the Dodgers and Giants' relocations out west in 1958, the Pacific Coast League was arguably its own little major league, a fully fledged, well-attended, hotly contested affair that featured some of the country's brightest talent that couldn't or wouldn't migrate eastward, including the Texas native Eghart. Spending most of his career with the PCL's Mission Reds and Seattle Indians, as well as other smaller minor league teams in Texas and Indiana. Across 14 seasons of minor league play, Eckhart holds the highest fully known career batting average, counting both major and minor league stats, at 0.3647. Higher even than Ty Cobb, whose minor league stats bring him down to 363. The only player who comes close to unseating Eckhart is Josh Gibson, who holds a higher batting average in the games that are documented, with a .368 according to Baseball Reference and a .365 according to Seamheads. However, given the incomplete nature of Gibson's stats, and given the averages are so close, I don't think it's possible to call conclusively in his favor. Eckhart's at-bats are about double the number of Gibson's. Although Eckhart lacked the home run pop typical for a corner outfielder of the era, his contact ability was legendary. He never hit below 350 in any Pacific Coast League season, and only hit below 300 once ever in his final age 38 season with the 1940 Western League Dallas Rebels. Eckhart hit an astronomical 315 hits in a single season in 1935, over 50 more than Ichiro Suzuki's single season hit record in 2004. Admittedly, part of this was because of the PCL's arduous over 180-game season, but there was certainly not any lack of rate dominance on Eckhart's part, who put together a PCL all-time record 415 batting average that year. I've already talked about his brief cups of coffee in the National League in 1932 and 1936, but he also played 11 games as a quarterback and halfback for the NFL New York Giants, scoring 2 rushing touchdowns. This puts him on a very short list of people with a page on both Baseball Reference and Pro Football Reference, if you're interested in that sort of thing. All in all, Eckhart finished his career with 2,599 hits and over 400 doubles. Although he will almost certainly never make it to Cooperstown, Ox Eckhart was finally recognized by the PCL Hall of Fame in 2003.
Really excited to see this guy on the ballot. Van Meter, Iowa, right-handed pitcher, Mr. Bob Feller. So, one of the best fastball pitchers of his era. Big stats here. 8-time All-Star. Triple Crown winner as a pitcher, 1940. Couldn't win a Cy Young because, hey, those didn't exist yet. But finished top 5 in MVP voting 4 times as a pitcher. It's pretty impressive. Led the league in wins 6 times, strikeouts 7 times, strikeouts per 9 5 times, shutouts 4 times, and innings pitched 7 times. Some of these innings pitched numbers, crazy. 343 innings, 371 innings. Like, compared to today, insane. Surpassed by modern pitchers, but retired with the 3rd highest career strikeout total. So one of the really dominant early strikeout pitchers. Struggled a little bit with control. Led the league in walks 4 times. Allowed the 5th most all-time walks. But hey, countering with the strikeouts. Threw 3 no-hitters and 12 one-hitters. So those are both American League records at his retirement. He likely would have hit 300 wins if not for World War II service. So he lost some time like many people did there. I think it was 3 years. He actually had an exemption to not have to go because his father had brain cancer, but he went anyway. Unlike many of the star players, he faced direct combat, held an immense pride in his service time, and when asked what was the greatest game he ever won, he would say World War II. That's solid. That's a good dude. Elected the inaugural president of the MLBPA in 1956, and was an advocate for, of course, free agency, spoke before Congress to criticize the reserve clause. So union man, we love union men here at ATG. Inducted into the Cooperstown Hall in 1962 alongside former ballot member Jackie Robinson, and both were the first ballot inductees since the inaugural class. So again, dominant pitcher of his era, Van Meter, Iowa, Bob Feller.
A lot has been said about the reclassification of the Negro Leagues as major leagues in 2020, and you know, good for them. It's given a lot of deserved spotlight to players of that era. But, at the same time, now that there exists a clean dividing line between what is major and what is not,
there's now a temptation to overlook stars from before a league organization who don't have as readily accessible statistics. And you know, that's not really fair to them. It's hard to be recognized for having major league caliber talent when an actual league of your peers for you to prove it in doesn't exist. So here's to Pete Hill, one of the first true superstars of black baseball. More than any other individual, Hill was the central player on the central pre-organized league teams of the 1900s and 1910s. Historian James Riley compared him to Ty Cobb and Tris Speaker in trying to pick the greatest outfielders of the dead ball era. Hill was a good all-around hitter who could hit for average and, what counted in the dead ball era as, power, as well as prove himself as a major threat on the base paths. Including his pre-organized league play, as per Seamheads, he possessed a 171 OPS plus across all levels of competition. He only entered official major league play at age 37, but could still clearly play. He put up 4.2 wins above replacement in about a single season's worth of plate appearances at ages most players are winding down their careers. In his quote-unquote debut season, he led his league with 38 walks, paired with a 443 on-base percentage. As an aside, he's probably the only player I've ever seen whose Sabre bio specifically called out his drag bunting ability as a plus. I don't know, I just thought that was funny. While lauded by anyone who played with him or against him, he was overlooked by even the Negro League press for a long time, not just for his age, but for his quiet and modest personality and reclusion from self-publicity, compared to some of the more theatrical and outspoken Negro League figures like teammate and NNL founder Rube Foster. However, on any level of inspection, his records speak for themselves, and he was finally inducted to Cooperstown in 2006.
Got a big one here. From Winters, Texas, a second baseman, a shortstop, a third baseman, Mr. Rogers Hornsby. Highest career jaws at second base all time. 6 seasons with a WAR above 10. 127 career WAR. Led the league in OPS 11 times. 8th all time in OPS plus, 175. 2 seasons with a raw OPS over 1.2. He's got the third highest career batting average in history, minimum 3,000 plate appearances at 358, behind only 2 people that recently fell off the ballot, Ty Cobb and Oscar Charleston. 1931, his last full-time season, he was second all-time in home runs behind only Hall of ATG inductee Babe Ruth. By 1937, his last season, he was fifth, still held onto most home runs by a second baseman until, on the ballot this month, Mr. Jeff Kent. He's a 2-time MVP, only one of 2 players to get a batting triple crown twice, along with 7 batting titles. Peak was incredibly good. Hardly any statistic that Hornsby wouldn't be at least respectable in. Frequently changed teams late in his career as he wore out welcomes. We might have to put him in the asshole wing of the Hall of ATG. Was a bit rough around the edges. Never saw a movie in a theater. Also never read books because he thought it would damage his eyesight. You can't hit if you can't see. So I feel that. MLB All-Century Team inductee, 1999. Winners, Texas, 127 career WAR, Rogers Hornsby.
NPB has produced a lot of great pitching over the years. From Masahiro Tanaka to Yu Darvish to Kodai Senga to modern wonder boy Roki Sasaki, it seems like almost every season there's a new pitcher who's doing something that's never been done before. And those are just the most famous guys Americans would know. The ones who have gotten to face MLB hitters in the regular season or World Baseball Classic. Yet despite this glut of talent over the decades, no Japanese pitcher has really been able to ever replicate the dizzying heights reached by one Masaichi Kaneda. Kaneda joins Cy Young and Walter Johnson as one of only 3 pitchers to have reached 400 wins, and is one of only 5 to have reached 4,000 strikeouts. in NPB competition, he's the only one to have done either. The win mark is particularly impressive since he spent most of his career on the hapless Swallows Club, which were otherwise terrible during his tenure. He also holds the record for the most losses, incidentally, with 298. Kaneda's high-velocity fastball, claimed to reach 100 miles an hour, and looping curveball made the lefty pitcher a premier strikeout threat. Over the course of his career, Kaneda won 3 Sawamura Awards, led the league in strikeouts 10 times, had 14 seasons with more than 20 wins, and was a 3-time ERA leader. Kaneda pitched a fairly insane workload by 1950s American standards, being both a full-time starter and a plug-in long reliever. He pitched 14 straight seasons with over 300 innings pitched. He topped at 400 in 1955. His 109 career wins above replacement, as calculated by NPBstats.com, is the highest of any NPB pitcher. Kaneda also once held the NPB record for ejections. He was a frequent target of umpires due to his temper. In terms of games that were individual high points, Kaneda pitched 2 no-hitters, one of which was a perfect game. It was the 4th perfect game in NPB history. They were weirdly common at this point in history. And he struck out Mickey Mantle 3 times in an exhibition match against the Yankees. Similar to NPB's best hitter, Sadaharu Oh, Kaneda's parents came from mainland Asia, in his case Korea, and arrived in Japan while their original home country was under Japanese imperial rule. Despite being born and raised in Japan, Kaneda did not achieve naturalized Japanese citizenship until 1959. And even then, I suspect it was expedited only due to his fame. Not only was Kaneda inducted to the Japanese Baseball Hall of Fame, he founded his own second Hall of Fame. The Meikyu Kai is a club of players who are granted membership for meeting certain statistical thresholds in NPB, intended as a networking ring. Finally, Kaneda also had the honor of being the namesake for the protagonist of the long-running mecha manga Tetsujin 28 Go, Iron Man number 28 in English, which is neat, I suppose.
Leaving the country for this one, we've got from Kumagun, Japan, left-handed first baseman Tetsuharu Kawakami. So, starting off here, his nickname was the God of Hitting. That is sick. He should be elected just on that. But in addition, career OPS plus 161, career batting average 313, and held the most hits by a Japanese League player at the time of his retirement. That was 2,351. Couple other accolades. He was a 3-time league MVP. He was an 8-time All-Star, won 5 batting titles, led the league in home runs twice, and RBIs twice. Only had 6 strikeouts in 1951 while playing a full season. Just stop and think about that for a second. It's crazy. Okay, moving on. Played his first 2 seasons in the JBL as a 2-way player. So he put up a 2.61 ERA with a 108 ERA plus in 200 innings as a pitcher. Guy could do it all. Arguably more legendary as a manager. So he led the Giants to 11 Japan Series appearances and won the series every time, including the V9 dynasty of 9 straight titles from 1965 to 1973. And a funny little anecdote that Toad put in here, similar to how Carl Yastrzemski replaced Ted Williams as a Red Sox left fielder, Kawakami's retirement season, 1958, next year, the first baseman, Sadaharu Oh, the world home run king. So cool little connection there. But yeah, great hitter, great Japanese player. Again, from Kumagun, Japan, first baseman, Tetsuharu Kawakami.
Probably the most succinct way to describe Lefty O'Doul would be to call him the greatest icon of early San Francisco baseball. But trying to pin it down more specifically than that is tricky, because there's almost no role in baseball that Lefty O'Doul has not held. Pitcher, batter, coach, manager, executive, evangelist of the game, O'Doul excelled on all of these fronts. After initially struggling to make it as a pitcher, he transitioned to left field and became one of his era's most productive contact hitters. He put up a career 349 average in MLB, the sixth highest of all time, minimum 3,000 plate appearances, and the highest of any non-Cooperstown player besides the band Julius Joe Jackson. He also tied a National League record in 1929 with 254 hits, and through his major league career he was a one-time All-Star, picked up two batting titles, and won the 1933 World Series with the New York Giants. But for all the success as a hitter in major league play, it's arguably a footnote compared to his importance to outsider baseball. For over three decades, Lefty O'Doul was the fulcrum around which West Coast baseball swung. In addition to, of course, excelling as a player there as well, he fell just shy of 400 in 1924 and reached the 30-30 club in 1927. He was a fixture of the San Francisco Seals as a manager, leading the Seals to become one of the era's most popular and successful ball clubs. As a manager, he compiled five PCL championships with the Seals, as well as over 2,000 wins. O'Doul was one of the best hitting instructors of his era. In particular, he was known as the early mentor of fellow Bay Area natives Joe and Dom DiMaggio. O'Doul attributed his success with the DiMaggios to basically just leaving the brothers alone and letting them hone their natural talent without any pressure. His status as a legend on the West Coast also allowed him to open up another new market, in Japan. O'Doul served as a baseball coach and goodwill ambassador in Japan before and after World War II, helping to establish both the JBL pre-war and NPB post-war. The Yomiuri Giants are named in honor of the team O'Doul played for during the 1934 American Tour of Japan, the New York Giants, and he oversaw the construction of the country's first permanent baseball stadium. Much like Victor Starfin, though, O'Doul sometimes faced difficulty working in Japan due to his non-Japanese heritage. O'Doul was once arrested in Tokyo with Ted Lyons while carrying a movie camera, on suspicions that the footage they were shooting was for American espionage. And once they cleared up the misunderstanding with that police precinct, they were just arrested again the next precinct over. As fascism ramped up in the late 1930s, O'Doul had to flee the country and did not return again until after the war. Fortunately, in the modern day, O'Doul's legacy as one of Japanese baseball's founding fathers has been unsuppressed and reasserted. He was inducted to the Japanese Baseball Hall of Fame in 2002, the second American and first foreigner without Asian ancestry to be given the honor. On the matter of his cousin, Tom O'Doul said, quote, "I know Lefty would be so proud and happy to see all of the great Japanese players in the majors right now, like Ichiro. Lefty envisioned an international game. I hope people remember what Lefty did for that country and its baseball. I believe it's his legacy," end quote. O'Doul was also inducted to the Pacific Coast League Hall of Fame and the Baseball Reliquary Shrine of the Eternals. A bridge over Mission Creek in San Francisco, just outside Oracle Park, is named the Lefty O'Doul Bridge in his honor. But probably his most personal legacy is the sports bar in his own name that he founded in 1958, which became a local landmark in San Francisco, noted for its Bloody Mary house recipe. The bar hosted patrons for more than 60 years, only shutting its doors recently due to COVID.
From Gretna, Louisiana, right fielder, third baseman, Mel Ott. Ott, just the third MLB player in history to reach 500 home runs and first to do so in the National League. At the time of his retirement, he had over 200 home runs, more than the second place National League hitter. He led his league in OBP four times, OPS twice, OPS plus five times, home runs six times. Also had a couple years leading the league in RBIs, runs, walks, and intentional walks. He's a 12-time All-Star. Also won a World Series championship 1933 with the Giants. Ton of power, despite a small size. Most career home runs by somebody 5'9 or below. Aside from his power, very notable for his ability to walk. So he drew 100 or more walks in a season 10 times, and never had a full season where he struck out more than he walked. So his home run totals are occasionally downplayed a little bit because he played at the Polo Grounds. We've all played on there on the show. Extremely short to dead right field. The thing you got to remember about that, though, the power alleys and anything in center, extremely long. So unless you can just pull it to right every time, it's going to even out probably. But great power hitter, over 500 home runs. Again, Gretna, Louisiana, Mr. Mellott.
Cristóbal Torriente was probably the greatest pre-integration Cuban player, at least purely on a hitting basis, i.e. anyone who isn't Diego. He has the third highest wins above replacement total for a Cuban-born player who played before 1947, after only Mini Meñoso and Dolph Luque, who both had a larger sample size of games due to playing in the American or National Leagues. Torriente won a batting title in the NNL's inaugural season with a .411 average. He also led his league in OPS twice, OBP three times, doubles twice, and RBIs once. All of which made him one of the best guys of his era if you wanted someone on base. He was also a pitcher in several seasons, although it never quite matched the heights of his batting career the way it did for Diego. In 407 and two-thirds innings of work, he put together an ERA of 3.95 and a 23-17 win-loss record. If this section seems a little short, I apologize. I was able to find frustratingly little about his life besides statistics. Even a Sabre bio is largely just a screed on how little is factually known about him versus what is folklore or anecdote. It specifically calls out Frankie Frisch's account of a 1920 game versus the Yankees as unsubstantiated. Which, not to soapbox, but it's irritating because I like talking about a legend's cultural importance or personality just as much or sometimes more than I do their on-field performance. The biggest anecdote I found about Torriente was probably not about his life, but about his death. There was apparently a controversy over whether he was actually buried in a communal grave in Queens, or whether his body was unearthed and relocated to Havana. The stronger evidence at this moment appears to point to Queens, but it's still not completely certain, and he remains the only Negro League Cooperstown inductee whose grave remains unmarked. The other thing I saw was two 1915 incidents where he kicked an umpire, the latter incident ultimately leading to a fight that spread onto the streets of Indianapolis after the game ended. But the article recounting this wasn't digitized, so I wasn't really able to go into detail. Well, sometimes, in the absence of a player's true voice, it's enough for their reputation and play to speak for itself. And that's certainly the case with Torriente. He was ranked the second best Negro League outfielder of all time in a Pittsburgh Courier poll, and none other than Martin Diego called him, quote, the best Cuban player that I have ever seen, end quote. He was one of the original inductees to the Cuban Baseball Hall of Fame in 1939, but only achieved recognition in Cooperstown in 2006.
Shawnee, Oklahoma's very own shortstop, third baseman, Mr. Willie Wells. Best all-around shortstop of the Negro Leagues. According to Toad, in his best recollection, one of only three players with a WAR above 50 from Negro League play, the other two being Bullet Rogan and Turkey Stearns. He's a 10-time All-Star, Triple Crown and a batting title in 1930. Probably could have won an MVP award if one had existed in the Negro Leagues. Hit .411 with a 1.174 OPS and an OPS plus of .214 in his Triple Crown season. Hit for great power as well as great contact. Led his league in home runs three times. Total bases four times. OPS once. Doubles three times. RBIs twice. And runs four times. So like a lot of the guys we're talking about, league leader in a lot of various categories. Member of the Newark Eagles million-dollar infield alongside Ray Dandridge, Dick Say, and Mule Suttles. Played for nine different Negro League franchises. In addition to stints in Mexico, Cuba, and Canada, he got around. His last recorded appearance on Baseball Reference came from a team in Branson, Manitoba, 1953. He was 48 years old. Dude loved to play baseball. Again, Shawnee, Oklahoma's very own Mr. Willie Wells. There we have it. Hall of ATG, April ballot. Those are the new faces that we're seeing. If anybody's listening at this point still, probably nobody is, but big shout out to Toad for putting all this information together. Big shout out to producer Jerry. Guys, we really got to elect somebody. I just hope that somebody off this list or our returners gets in. Ballot has been released, I believe, at this point. Hopefully, you've listened. You've educated yourself a little bit on some of these guys. And when you go to vote, you can make an informed decision. And hopefully, we can get somebody in this month. For myself, for Toad, for Jerry, thank you for listening. We'll see you next time. Everybody knows that's how it goes. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. Everybody knows. That's how it goes. Everybody knows. Everybody.